Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Sunday morning service. And it's a special day. It's a special day today, isn't it? Being Father's Day, and yes, it's going to be a good morning. I think we've got some lovely things lined up for you, and we continue with our sermon series on being wise. And we're looking this week at being wise about the Christian message. And I'm just going to pass over to Caroline now. And she's got I think hopefully she'll say good morning. And then she's got a prayer for this morning to start us with.
Yes, good morning, everybody. Just thought we'd start with a prayer for Father's Day. Bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for Father's Day today. We are aware that for many it's a day of celebrating with our dads, saying thank you to them for all that they are to their children. We're also very aware that it is a day of sadness, that there are many whose fathers have died, many who are not able to be with their fathers right now due to the coronavirus, and that there are also some whose fathers are not good role models. We ask you to bless all fathers, guide them, let them look to your example, to parent with patience, unconditional love and understanding. Thank you that you, our Heavenly Father, are perfect in every way. We're going to move into a time of a song, and it's a beautiful song. It's called You Are a Good, Good Father, That's Who You Are. It's an instrumental. It's a little bit difficult to sing the words, but we just thought it was worth playing this, and Peter will lead us in his singing. So here we go.
And stories of heart, they think you're like a knife. Heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. Who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you, it's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, you know just what we need. say, oh God, you're as good, good Father. It's who you are. Perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways to God. Perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways. Perfect in all of your ways to God. So undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am.
Some beautiful words there just to assure us of who each one of us are this morning. And we're going to start with our prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we just have a reminder here of the commandments, and Jesus summed up all the commandments with these words. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Amen. Lord, have mercy. And so we were reminded in the Beatitudes that Jesus says, blessed are the humble, blessed are the meek, blessed are the peacemakers, those that make their peace with God and those that make their peace with each other through the process of forgiveness and reconciliation. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. We say together, most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. And we serve an almighty God, a loving Heavenly Father, who forgives all who truly repent. Have mercy upon us. May he pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And our special prayer, the collect for today. Faithful Creator, whose mercy never fails, deepen our faithfulness to you and to your living word, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. We've got, as always, a treat for you this morning. And our treat is somebody reading our day's passage. So we are reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and it's verses 1 to 16. Please do dig out your Bibles and read along with Vicky, who's doing our reading for us this morning. So 1 Corinthians chapter 2.
The reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 to 16. When I came to you, brothers, I did not come with eloquence or superior wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I came to you in weakness and fear and with much trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on men's wisdom, but on God's power. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we speak of God's secret wisdom, a wisdom that has been hidden and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it. For if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, as it is written, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed it to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the man's spirit within him? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. We have not received the Spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is what we speak, not in words taught us by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, expressing spiritual truths in spiritual words. The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual man makes judgments about all things, but he himself is not subject to any man's judgment. For who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be
to God. The reading is taken from 1.
Oh, that was beautifully read by Vicky. And isn't it lovely that we can have others join us in taking part in the service? So let's just bow our heads, shall we, for a prayer. Father God, we thank you this morning for your word to us, and thank you that your word is living and active. Help us this morning to be wise. Give us that gift of godly wisdom as we read and understand your word this morning. We pray this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I don't know about you, but I find that if someone is not interested in Jesus and you try to talk to them about Jesus and the cross, they will do everything that they can to deflect the conversation. So maybe you're talking about what happened with Jesus on the cross, how he was the one who died for everyone, and so that everyone can come before God and ask for the forgiveness of their sins. And it was through his death and resurrection that we can have life in terms of a full relationship with God and a full relationship with each other. But if you're trying to talk about the cross, they will do things like say, do you think God created the dinosaurs? Or maybe they will say, do you believe in evolution? Or even they would say, well, what are you having for tea tonight? Or, oh, I like the fact that you've had your hair done. Anything to prevent us from talking about the Christian message. Last week, we spoke a little bit about this, and The passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, there's one verse that it says this. For this is Paul speaking. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might be emptied of its power. And so I've got a few sayings here about the cross. And here's one. I owed a debt which I couldn't pay. Christ paid a debt that he didn't owe. Morality will keep you out of jail, but only the blood of Jesus will keep you out of hell. And here's another one. This is from David Watson. The cross, it's the picture of violence, yet the key to peace. A picture of suffering, yet the key to healing. A picture of death, yet the key to life. A picture of utter weakness, yet the key to power. A picture of capital punishment, yet the key to mercy and forgiveness. A picture of vicious hatred, yet the key to love. A picture of supreme shame, yet the Christian's supreme boast. Well, I think those are really good things just to sort of help us as we get into thinking about being wise about the Christian message. How do we talk about Jesus? How do we talk about the Christian message without getting deflected? Well, when I came to this parish 7 years ago, gosh, can you believe it? 7 years ago, some would say time has flied. Some might say something different. But when I came 7 years ago, and I think I've mentioned this before, I said I would preach nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I didn't come with a sense that, if you like, that I could do this in my own strength. But I came in a sense that, if you like, that I was coming in the knowledge of my weakness, in fear and trembling. And, my weakness is I know, made perfect in God's strength, in the power of his Holy Spirit. So I believe I've continued to do this, regardless of, you know, whether I wanted to be popular. Sometimes quite a few people have disagreed or not agreed. And I hope I've spoken about the cross in a way that is straightforward. And over the last couple of weeks, we've had the passage of the Great Commission. So what are we called to do as Christians? And also we find that in Acts chapter 18, 1 to 11, which is where Paul gave us an account of coming to the city of Corinth, there's an amazing similarity. Paul was sent to Corinth, so he obeyed the command to go. He preached the gospel to the people of Corinth, where many believed and were baptized and saved, and Paul continued to teach them God's word. I think, sadly, that what is happened at Corinth is sadly happening in many churches today. People are mixing, bless you.
Excuse me.
People are mixing human wisdom or philosophy or ideology or ideas with God's message. And this is causing division and confusion. And Paul, he explains three functions of the three fundamentals, as you were, as if you were, would like, of the gospel message. Firstly, the gospel centers in the death of Christ. Chapter 2 starts with the word accordingly or and so. And if you look at the last verse of chapter 1, you'll say that this whole thing is launched on the basis of being to the glory or for God's glory. Corinth was full of clever people depending on their own wisdom to gain followers. Paul simply declares God's word in the power of the Spirit. He was an ambassador, not a salesman, and his attitude was that of a humble servant. He bought nothing that Christ might be everything. Years later, Paul brought this up again when there were more false teachers having invaded the church itself. And you can read about that in 2 Corinthians 10, verses 1 to 12. Paul depended on the power of the Holy Spirit, and his preaching, as it said in our reading, was a demonstration. And this word in Greek means legal proof presented in court. So he was presenting something that was proof, a demonstration. He was showing that this was true. In verse 5, Paul reminded them of his aim. He wanted them to trust in God and not in the messenger God sent. There are so many people who put their trust in the person giving the message, but not in God. And of course, any human being is going to fall over or say something wrong or do something wrong. But if your trust is in God, then that is the place to place it. You're on solid foundation. Put your trust in God. So my job, the job of a preacher, is to preach the word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to do the rest. I personally have never brought anyone to Christ. This is all about the Holy Spirit and his witness to people that they are saved. So the gospel, the second point then, is the gospel is part of the Father's eternal plans for you and for me. Salvation was purchased by Jesus. We were saved by Jesus through his blood, but it was planned by the Father in the power of the Holy Spirit. The gospel is both simple enough for anyone to understand, believe, and be saved, and yet so profound that the most brilliant theologians cannot fathom its depths. That is the wisdom of God. It's for mature believers who are growing in their understanding, wow, of the Word of God. I love that sense of the simplicity of the gospel, and yet it is so difficult for those to get their minds around. The most brilliant thinkers, it is, and it can be a hurdle for that. In the gospel, we talk and hear about Jesus saying, come in a childlike manner, not childish, childlike. Accept the simplicity of the good news of the gospel. And we hear in our reading, it does not come from man. It has been hidden, but now is revealed in the person of Jesus Christ to the people of God. God set the plan in motion, and we'll see it through that it succeeds. And this wisdom, it results in the glory of God's wisdom. And verse 8 is hidden from the unsaved world. Do you know, even Satan did not understand what was going on at when Jesus was crucified. He thought he had the victory. And then somehow, in that reversal, the cross turned it all on its head. And there's these beautiful words, isn't there, in our reading? No eye has seen, no ear has heard. And it's an adaptation from Isaiah. The things that God has prepared for those who love him. Do you know, for those who love God, every day is a good day. Romans 8:28 tells us, and we know in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and have been called. So the truths of the gospel, they're centered on the death of Jesus. It's part of the Father in heaven's eternal plans. But the people of Corinth had forgotten the cost of their rescue, the cost of their salvation. They had taken their eyes off the cross. They had lost their wonder of God's plan for them. And they needed to return to the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And that is the third point. The gospel is revealed by the Holy Spirit through the Word of God. You see, for each one of us, when we were saved, it was through God's grace. He chose you, he chose me, he chose Caroline. Wow, he chose us. Our salvation, being saved, involves the Son through his sacrifice, through his blood being shed on the cross, so that we can know the forgiveness of our sins, so that we can know that we are able to enter into our Father's presence. And of course, it involves the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the one that does the conviction of where we are not right with God, and also the renewing of the way we think, the renewing of our hearts. And you see, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, he lives in us. The moment you trusted in Jesus, God's Holy Spirit took up residence and made your body his temple. Wow. The Spirit searches all things and sees even the deeper things of God. God wants us today to know the blessings of his grace, the gifts of the Holy Spirit that he promises as a good father to all those who ask him. And then thirdly, the Spirit teaches in verse 13. The Spirit teaches us the truth of God, his wisdom is found in God's word. It comes alive. His word comes alive because of the Holy Spirit working in us and making those connections, which is why we read, meditate, pray, and think each day on God's word. The Spirit is the one that makes the believer mature. And we come back to that sense of the saved and the unsaved. The unsaved person does not accept God's word. The saved person is spiritual. You and I have been born again into this heavenly family through being born again spiritually. And that gives sight and ability to see beneath the surface of life and to see how things really are. That is spiritual sight. That is from God's wisdom. Unsaved people walk by their physical sight and really see nothing, as they are spiritually blind. And they do not understand the Christian. The Christian lives in a different world. But the Christian understands the unsaved person, and our hearts are moved with compassion. Blessed are they who understand and share all the counsel of God. Let's just pause on those words and pray for a moment. Father God, we thank you. We thank you that by your Holy Spirit, by being filled with your Holy Spirit, you teach us. We know that your word is good for teaching us, but also for rebuking us, for correcting us. And so, Lord, as we listen to your word this morning, we ask that your Holy Spirit would work in our hearts, fill us afresh. Lord, teach us what is not of you. Shape us, mold us, Lord. Help us to become more like you, Jesus, our Lord and our Saviour. And we pray this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
And we're going to continue with our prayers. And so, Father God, we pray for your world. Lord, we pray in these days for an outpouring of your Spirit. Jesus, reveal yourself to the nations, we pray. And during this time of this pandemic, we want to say thank you. We give thanks for those scientists that have found that breakthrough. And thank you for the way in which that was so quickly shared around the world. Lord, on this day, we pray that you would would reveal yourself through these breakthroughs. Lord, we pray for all of those who are grieving at this time because of the virus. Father, we pray, we are reminded that we are called to pray, but when you look at the figures, each one, Lord, was a human being, precious in your sight, made in your image. Lord, this morning, as we have read your word, we pray that by your Holy Spirit, you would give us a new compassion for those who do not know you. Move by your Spirit, we pray, in our hearts. Help us to be wise about how we use and give the Christian message, that message of hope that this world so needs in these days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for the governments around the world. We pray for our Queen. We thank you for her life and her faithfulness. We pray for her government. Lord, that you would reveal yourself to those in power, that they would not rely on human wisdom, but would understand what it is to rely on your godly wisdom. And Lord, this prayer comes with that hope and that prayer that by your Holy Spirit that you'd reveal yourself and those in power would turn to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for our country. Father, we particularly want to pray for the situation and the horrible stabbings that have happened in Reading only last night. We pray for those three families that have had loved ones taken away through this awful event. We pray for those who are seriously ill in hospital. Lord, we pray that you would pour out your love, your compassion, and your peace into that situation, into that place. And Father, we continue to pray for the NHS, for all those working on the front line. But Lord, we also pray for people who are struggling financially, for those who have uncertainty of jobs and of businesses. Lord, over this week, we pray for those places that have reopened, and we pray that you would put the right things in place to keep people safe. Lord, please help those people use common sense. And Lord, I pray for common sense just in terms of all these things as the lockdown is gradually relaxed. Father, we pray for teachers across our land who have been working so hard over these 3 months. Particularly, we pray for head teachers in this parish. We pray for the head teacher at Boundary School. We pray for the head teacher at Leighton School, for Higher Furlong School, for Blackpool Aspire Academy, for Blackpool Sixth Form, for Steyning Church of England School. Lord, for Christ the King, for St. Mary's Academy. Lord, for all the staff in these places, Lord, that have been working so hard. And Lord, as they try and assess and make difficult decisions for bringing children back into school, Lord, we pray that you would grant them favour in their work. Lord, we pray for parents who have been struggling with children at home. We pray for households where tensions have been rising. Lord, grant them your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we pray for those struggling still with isolation and loneliness. We pray for those who are unwell. And finally, Lord, we pray for those known to us who are grieving, for the family and friends of Jason, for the family and friends of Lorraine Crossan's brother. May they know your peace and comfort at this time. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we're going to sing again. And let me find this. And I think it's a wonderful song that we're going to sing. Here we go. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, but through the fiercest drought and storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace, when days are still, when striving cease, my comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied, for every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. Light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. I am his, he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. This is the power of Christ in me, from life's first cry to final breath. Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man, can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. Oh, just a wonderful reminder of the gospel message, so clearly laid out in those words that we've just sung. And as we're reminded of the gospel message, we know that as people we can have peace with God and peace with each other. And Jesus came and stood amongst his disciples and offered them that peace that the world does not understand. And so may the peace of the Lord always be with you and also with you. And we're just going to come into a time now of sharing bread and wine. And I'm reading verses from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And chapter 10, sorry, chapter 11. And these are the verses 23 to 26. And it tells us this: "For this is what the Lord himself said, and I pass it on to you just as I received it. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and you, sealed by the shedding of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again.'" Caroline, the body of Christ broken for you.
Amen.
The blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. The blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. Let's try that again. There we go. These are the words I'm after. Sorry about that. This isn't working for me. Sorry, everyone. I'll be there in the moment with the right words. It's not quite so clear. No, that's not right either. I'm so sorry. Let me just say a final blessing over you. And it's been lovely to join with you this morning. And this is the words from the priestly blessing, and let's just pray together as we think on those words we've shared this morning. So may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and to serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. So thank you for joining with me this morning. It's been lovely to be with you. Just a few notices, as it were. Please do keep praying and for the transition of the Need to Feed project. That's basically as of this week, we're reducing what we're doing as we gradually come out of shutdown. Please just pray for that. Please pray for Matthew and his wife Sarah and their son Elisha as they settle into the parish. But also 10 o'clock next Saturday is Matthew's licensing. He'll be licensed initially, and then God willing, on the 26th of September, will be ordained in Blackburn Cathedral. That is our hope. So please do just make a note of that. So there won't be a morning prayer next Saturday. It will be, hopefully, I've asked the diocese if they can stream it onto the Diocesan Facebook page, and I will do a watch party onto our own. So you should be able to pick that up, I hope, next Saturday. So, yeah, stay safe. Keep praying for one another, and keep on keeping on, as they say. All right, lots of love, and we'll see you in this way next week. Yeah, God bless.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.